Alright, hello everyone, welcome to a new Let's Play that we really haven't officially started yet. I am SIMSteven, also known as Master Fenral, and Merry Christmas! I'm actually kind of doing this as a bit of a surprise Christmas gift for a friend of mine. So, Dark Kefka, if you're watching this, this episode's for you! So, back during Halloween, Dark Kefka, friend of mine, had done a live stream on Twitch for Lollipop Chainsaw, and during that live stream I asked him if he wanted to see me do a Let's Play of this game, because he has recently become a big fan of this franchise, but he's not played the first game in the series. And we're not officially starting this Let's Play yet, but I figured I'd do this for Christmas' sake, because, well, what better way to celebrate the birth of Jesus than with an occult game, or a cult classic, as I would rather prefer to refer it to. Well, there's that butterfly. I'm pretty sure anyone who's familiar with this franchise knows a little bit about the significance of said butterfly. So I decided that for this week's update, Suikoden 2 is going to take a very dark turn soon in the story, so I figured it'd be kind of off-color to do another episode of that. So I thought about my other Let's Plays. Armored Core Project Phantasma is probably the least dark Let's Play that I could be doing this week. But again, that's all about killing and destroying mechs and stuff like that, so possibly not the best thing for a Christmas episode. And Grandia, well, the world had just been destroyed in the last episode of Grandia, so also not really all that bright and cheery for a Christmas episode. But I've been thinking about doing this series for a long time. And the main reason I've been kind of holding back on this series is because I don't even own the second game in the franchise. I own the third and fourth, and the fifth just came out very recently. I don't know if it's come out here in America yet, but it's already out in Japan. But we're doing the first episode of Persona here, and already getting into the religious undertones here with that red cross on the title screen. Don't worry, it's a lot more tasteful than I'm making it out to be. A lot of the religious themes are simply abilities, kind of like how, you know, in Final Fantasy a lot of the summons are based on mythological creatures or pagan gods or just various other gods and other religions. Like, I think Shiva and Ifrit are from, oh god, what was it? Something out in the Middle East? Was it Islamic? I'm not entirely sure, but a lot of these abilities that you get in the game are called personas, and essentially what the personas are alter egos of yourself. So let's say, well, the game will explain a little bit better, but inside each and every one of us are different personalities. And under normal circumstances, we cannot draw those out and use them to manifest in the material world and, you know, cast fire and all that. But due to circumstances that happen in this game, we're actually able to do that and summon up our inner demons, or inner angels, as the game will put it. And, well, use them to fight other demons and angels that will eventually be a major factor in this game and what we'll be fighting and so on and so forth. But right now, we're a bunch of high schoolers performing an occult ritual. Great Christmas episode, Sim! really, it's not that bad, it's not that sacrilegious, but this episode, for the most part, will be very bright and cheery. With the exception of maybe just this thing here and maybe something at the end of this episode, which is something I got planned on how to end off the episode. But yeah, we're kind of doing just this make-believe, we're going to play Persona like a bunch of little kids or high schoolers or something like that. Oh no, it's just kind of a game that we're doing out of curiosity, and out of theory, we can just summon occult stuff and stuff. I don't know. But either way, we've got Mark here. First person to talk in the game, and he's actually a pretty cool dude. And he's talking to a guy named Brad. By the way, all the characters in this room are party members, or they can be. Some of them are optional, and I'll go into that in just a little bit. But for now, we're just going to go on with the story and, well, read the text. Wait up, Brad. What are you? We're going to play Persona? What? Are you stupid? Mark is a troublemaker who gets into mischief. He doesn't get along with Nate. No, you're stupid. Persona will work. Trust me, man. I'll even bet you on it. Brad demands a lot of attention. He's conceited and very irresponsible. All right, then. Loser treats us all to dinner at Peace Diners. Okay, I'll bet I'm Brad. Elena is also a troublemaker and a total airhead. She's very irresponsible. And I think she's the only one out of all of us that doesn't wear a school uniform. At least she has a jacket on over her school uniform. Not 100% sure on this. And who's next? Ellen? I bet I'd Brad too. Ellen studied in Europe and came back to America with beauty and knowledge. Okay, got a nitpick here. This is totally not America. This is totally Japan, and we'll get into my reasoning for that later, but I think this is one of those situations where you can say that the localization went a little too well, or they tried to make it too American when they brought it over from Japan, because, well, this was originally a Japanese game. And then it got, well, localized and brought over to America, and then I don't know if it got over to Europe originally, but this is the original PlayStation 1 version, so yeah, we'll get back to that in just a sec. But yes, this is totally not America. Hey, wait up. What's going on here? So everyone's betting on Brad. And Mark is like, hey, it ain't gonna work. Nate, Yuki, what side are you on? Psh, I don't care. Nate is the heir to the Trinity Family Trust. He's very bossy. I don't care either. Do whatever you guys like. Yuki, a very trustworthy and responsible girl who many... Yuki is a very trustworthy and responsible girl who many students respect and trust. Forgot the is in that sentence, game designers. Well, I guess the localization didn't go too well, but they tried to make it too American, I guess. You guys suck as usual. What about you? Who are you going to bet on? You're on me, right? I'm going to bet on Mark, because he's my buddy. And I really, really like him. You'll regret it. You'll be sorry. Okay, let's begin. Alright, so, apparently the occult ritual that we're going to be doing involves us doing chants and running in circles. Okay, well, here I go. Persona, please come to us. Persona, come here. Damn, why the heck are we doing this? Come on, this is for all you can eat. Hurry up. Okay. Persona, come here. Okay, it's my turn. Persona, please come to us. Here it comes. What? Yes, straight up, boy.
Hey, Red, don't I look stupid now?
I guess our bets were right. Oh, yeah. What's up now? Looks like I win.
Are you happy now? Let's go.
Wait, let's try one more time, okay?
Mark didn't try hard enough.
Shut the heck up. You trying to blame me for your mistakes?
Uh-oh. Hey, Mark. Look behind you.
What's up? Don't be trying to trick me. Bet's still on. What the?
What is that? Is it real? Last time we did this, we only heard sounds. This time we're seeing images. See, I told you something would happen. Now do you believe me?
Help me, help!
What?
What's happening?
It's fantastic. It's so intriguing.
Ah! Watch out, everybody. Ah! What a shocker! We got hit by lightning. And we're out for the count for a little while, it seems. Interestingly enough, the four of us that got hit, Yuki, Mark, Nate, and myself, are going to be our first four party members. But we've got a bit of a cutscene here to listen to, so I guess I'll shut up for a minute here.
Welcome. My name is Philemon. I live between the world of consciousness and unconsciousness. So tell me, who are you?
Boy, that dude is stiff as a doll. Stiff as cardboard. You can tell this is pretty early PS1 era game because of how kind of rudimentary the graphics are and the 3D modeling is. So, in case you couldn't figure it out, my real name is Steve. I mean, after all, I use the internet name SIMSteven, so my name is obviously John, right? No. Now, there's something weird with the naming here. With how you choose the, you know, the proper case or all caps, the text in the game will look weird either way. They didn't really do the greatest of formatting when they did their text, and I'll show what I mean in just a minute here. But if I pick my name like this, it'll look normal when it's, you know, in normal dialogue boxes when characters are talking, and talking to me directly. So, we're just going to name him after me.
Excellent. There are not many who know their own identity when they have come to this point. It seems you have passed the first test. By the way, have you noticed you carry more than one you in yourself? Perhaps the merciful you, the graceful angel you, or the cruel, demonic you. We live behind many masks. And you may at this very moment be living behind many masks. But you claimed your name, proving you know who you really are. I admire your strong will and bestow my power unto you. Persona, the power to call on others within you, sometimes merciful, sometimes cruel. These selves are embedded deep within your soul. This power will help you through your quest into the future. Go back now into your world, the world that's locked between time and space.
All right. Alright, so he kind of explained what I already did, but possibly a little bit better. Essentially, Persona, the ability system of the game, is our ability to call upon other persons within ourselves. And there's some people talking. And we could just barely hear them. We're kind of unconscious. And they were saying something about maybe he's having the same dream that we had. And they're talking about me, of course. But yes, the Persona is the ability system, which is also what the game is named after. And like I was saying before, it's alter egos within yourself. And a lot of the Personas are actually things like pagan gods or mythological creatures and so on and so forth. So that's kind of what I was saying, you know, this is kind of like a anti-religious cultist kind of game. No, it's really not. It's kind of like how Final Fantasy uses, various, you know, they're called different things in most games, but Espers or Eidolons or Summon Monsters are derived from, you know, things from mythology and so on and so forth. Although this game actually does acknowledge the fact that these are from religious and mythological, you know, scriptures, writings, stories, so on and so forth. Even dead religions like, you know, Roman and Nordic mythology and all that and so forth. So, yeah, that's just kind of a rough description of what Personas really are. And, well, apparently we can summon those things from deep within ourselves, but not quite yet. We gotta do some more story before that. Oh, Steve, you're finally awake. Welcome to the school's infirmary. How are you feeling? Dr. Beverly is a school doctor. Cooking is not one of her specialties. Steve, are you okay? Again, totally not America, based on, you know, how some of these characters look. Good, I'm glad you're awake now. Steve, don't ever do that to me. I was worried sick when I heard you passed out. Mrs. Smith is a sweet person with a bright personality. She is Steve's teacher. Thank you, doctor, for taking care of my students. Well, she is a doctor. That's what she's supposed to do. It's no big deal. Mark, don't be so rude. Anyway, Ellen and Alana told me everything that happened. I think all of you should go to the hospital for a checkup. Mark, you can forget about the tension today. Just go with everyone to the hospital. Again, he's a bit of a troublemaker, so yeah. He had attention for something he did. Why, do you think there's something wrong with us? I can see you're all fine just by looking at you, but you could have bumped your head when you fell, so go have yourselves checked. Sometimes you worry about us too much. Okay, we'll go to the hospital. Mrs. Smith, are you talking about the hospital where one of your students is being treated? You mean Mary? Yes, she's been there for a while now. Sure, she'll be very happy if you guys went to pay her a visit. Alright, so, first off, we're going to raid this item box and get an herb. Okay, so, one thing I like to point out, purple trees are your save point. I know in future games, I think the save point is actually that butterfly that apparently we dream that we are when we go to that, mid-dimensional, between consciousness and subconsciousness realm where we saw that dude in the cutscene. His name is Philomar. I don't know how important he's actually going to be, because the thing is, I've never actually finished this game, and that's kind of one of the reasons why I've been wanting to do Let's Plays of this, is I was wanting to do a blind Let's Play of this entire series, so I talked about Dark Kefka before, and he wanted to do Persona 3, and start off there when he did his live streams on Twitch. And I specifically didn't watch whenever he was doing story, but I would come and hang out sometimes whenever he was, you know, not doing anything particular with the story. So I was watching when he was doing things like grinding levels and so on and so forth. So yeah, that's kind of why I... or how I learned how he got into, you know, this entire series. And I'm going here for a specific reason. But tabling that conversation for now, I want to go into the menu and show you that we have... Oh, crap. This controller system is a bit awkward. Circle is actually the button you have to open the menu with, rather than the normal triangle or square button which most other games use. And also what I was saying before is, oh, if you use proper keys like I did, it'll look weird on this screen, on the menu screen, because everyone else's names are in all caps. But if you put your name in all caps to match theirs, it'll look weird when people are actually talking about you in the actual story. So it's really one of the other pick your poison kind of deal. And, well, we obviously got, you know, we're level 5. They didn't start us off at level 1. Apparently it was a thing back in the day to start you off at least pre-leveled a bit. Just kind of wanted to, what else did I want to show? Oh yeah, I also wanted to talk about Yuki here. And just the fact that you can see that we can also have one more party member. As far as these four party members go, the main character, who I'm named Steve, after myself, Nate and Mark, are three required characters. No exceptions to this rule. There will be a fourth character later that will also be permanent, and you have no choice in the matter but to use that character. And we'll be getting that person not in this episode, probably not for a good two or three episodes. And like I said before, this LP has not been officially started, but yeah, we're not going to be seeing that character for a while now. But the fifth character is variable. In that room, we saw Brad, Elena, and Ellen, and also Yuki here. Now, Yuki is in our party only temporarily. In the Japanese version, and I think in later patch versions that they re-released or remade slightly, Yuki actually becomes a permanent party member if you do an alternate story mode in this game. Yes, this game actually has two different, entirely different stories from one another, and, well, either due to localization constraints or time constraints or something like that, that second story is not here in the original American PS1 version, but I believe it's in the Japanese PS1 version. They just, probably didn't have time to translate it all. But essentially, in order to get that normally, if you were to hack the game or something like that, or to get a later version of this, there is a bunch of stuff you gotta do in school, and it's known as the Ice Queen quest, and Yuki becomes your fourth party member, and not that other character we'll be getting later. But the fifth character is variable, and it's either going to be Brad, Ellen, Elena, or a character that we'll be meeting in just a second here. But first we gotta talk to this teacher in the brown coat, just to the right of the entrance to the school. Hey Steve, I'm glad you came. I wanted to ask you something. I've heard complaints about something running in and out of the sealed classroom on the second floor. You mean all of us at the very beginning of the game? No, that's not what he's referring to. But it's that one character who is a secret character. And we're going to be going on his route. His name is Chris, because we're going to see him in just a minute. I don't think I feel like I'm going to be spoiling that very much here. But yeah, Chris is a secret character, and essentially in order to get him, you have to do a lot more work to get him. Like I've said before, the fifth character is one of all these characters. One of four characters, Brad, Ellen, Elena, or Chris. But Chris requires work to get. Everyone else, you either say, hey, come with us, or hey, don't come with us at certain points in the story. Whereas Chris has like a 12-step process in order to get him as your fifth party member. And I'm on the wrong floor. So shut up, please. I did not mean to go in this room. I'm supposed to go to, what, room 28, I think? And, well, we'll go back the way we came because I screwed up. I'm going to point something out here in the dungeon mode. Now this is typically how you're going to be exploring dungeons later in the game, is in first person mode. It's a lot more like old school RPGs where, you know, dungeon was front, forward, backward, left and right in first person mode. Very old school RPGs, by the way. I think, yeah, this is the room, because you can see we got 2-6 on the left over there, 2-5 over the right there, And oddly enough, this room here does not have a label for the room number. So this is actually the sealed classroom that we were in when we started our adventure here. Apparently, we can actually go inside the sealed classroom now that we've talked to that teacher in the brown coat. And we get to meet Chris here. Who's there? Yo, Chris, what the heck are you doing here? Chris came to St. Hermelin 6 months ago. He's rather quiet and always excellent. And he says absolutely nothing and runs out of here. Didn't want to get caught, I suppose. Damn, what a rude punk. That's his style. Alright, so lone wolf and all that. And apparently we're in the sealed classroom, which is supposed to be sealed, but was apparently unsealed by Chris there. What's up with him? I think he's trained to become a hitman or something. Actually, I think he's going to be a stage magician based on his abilities, but I digress. Can he move into the town right after Zebek moved in? Anyway, we need to get to the hospital. What was he doing in a place like this? And I am doing a terrible job sounding British, because that's what Neat's voice actor sounds like when he's in battle. I don't remember what Yuki sounds like, but Mark just sounds kind of normal. Even though I'm trying to give him something of a bit of a southern accent and failing horribly. But either way, actually, there's one more step that I gotta do here in school to get Chris. I think we need to go back up to the second floor, go all the way around. And I think it's the first room over here. It's apparently 2-1. Yeah, I think this is the room. I did not mean to hit circle. I'm so used to most games having circle as the button to run, but apparently in this game it's triangle. So you talk to this student here, and he says, don't you think they should tear down these old useless buildings? All the gangsters around here like to use them as their hangout. Gangsters? There ain't any gangsters around here. Shut up, there are. I've seen them throw parties in with them. Mark, you aren't a part of that, are ya? Steve, this dude goes on about nothing. Here, you talk to him. So, we gotta talk to those two for a sec about gangsters in the area. And then I think we can leave the school properly. Oh, I'm going the wrong way. And head off towards the hospital. We're not going there quite yet. But Chris has a lot of prerequisites in order to get him as a main party member. And oddly enough, if you're going to get Chris, it's both easy mode and hard mode at the same time. Because in the beginning of the game, it'll be a lot harder because you're forced to do a bunch of dungeons with 4 party members rather than 5. But near the end of the game, if you have Chris, he apparently gets some of the strongest personas in the game, and only he can use them. So it's a bit of a trade-off. Make the game harder at the beginning, but things will be easier at the end. So, yeah. I'm pretty sure the requirements to get those personas are really hellacious to do. So, yeah. You guys are sluts. Let's hurry up and visit our friend Mary. I'm not even trying the British accent right now. What's up with Nate? Damn, he pisses me off. I'll probably never like him. Nate, Mark, grow up. So like I was saying about Yuki before, since we don't have a whole lot of time to really talk about her. Oh, wait, hold on a sec. We got Alfred! Said Nate! Alfred? What a pretty sight. Nate is with his friends, talking and walking together. I'm so happy! Alfred is the butler of the Trinity Mansion. He treats Nate as if he was his own son. Sir Nate. Alfred, I thought I told you to stop calling me that. What the? Sir Nate? apparently Mark thinks this is funny. Shut up, Mark, you stupid pest. Alfred, go home. We're going somewhere with my friends today. Shall I get the limo for you and your friends, Sir Nate? There's no need for that. We're just going to the hospital. Stop calling me that.
Hospital, are you injured, son Nate?
damn it, let's go, Steve. Don't fall us, Alfred. Okay, so that's kind of a bit of a funny. So anyways, I was saying about Yuki, she is the only character we cannot really get as on a permanent basis, but she's in our party for now, and only temporarily. So yeah, she's not going to be available for much longer. Now, typically what I like to do when I play this game is I'm a bit of an item hoarder. I'm going the wrong way. Now, if I push L2, you get a map of the town, and I need to go to Joy Street. Joy Street next. It's a mall, kind of near the center of town. And there's someone I need to talk to while we're there. Now, this person is also relevant to getting Chris, and we heard talk about the factories and the gangsters and all that. But before that, we actually have to talk to Chris's mom. So, oh, by the way, staple of the Persona series, the Velvet Room, where Igor is, but the store is closed. And this is also why I was saying this game is actually in Japan, even though they tell us it's in America. I mean, we got all these Japanese shops in the mall. So, yeah. They tried to make it a little too American, but then couldn't take things out like this, like a Japanese medicine shop or whatever it is. And speaking of which, there's one other shop I really need to show here real quick. I think it's the pharmacy? Or was it... No, it's not Peace Diner. I don't think it's Peace Diner. I think it's the pharmacy. I'm just going to shop here in case this is the one. Okay, enough of that. I shut up there for a second because of the music in that store, and it's being sung by a Japanese person. So, yeah. And also Yin and Yang Shop. So, yes, this is totally Japan, totally not America, even though the game will tell you it's America. So, anyways, this is the store with Chris's mom, and, well, we gotta talk to her if we want to get Chris in our party later. Oh, you guys go to St. Hermelin. The same school my son goes to. Do you know him? Chris's mother, it says. His name is Chris. You know him? Oh, you're in the same class with him. Oh, really, I know that Chris isn't very sociable. Probably not asking too much, but can you be friends with Chris? Okay. Oh, really? Thank you very much. Please come over to our house sometime. Now, I believe if you talk to her a second time, you're screwed out of getting Chris. So don't do that. Instead, just keep going with all the prerequisites to getting Chris here. Also, in a minute, I'll be going over this room. Because I'm going to be loading up a save file that I've already been working on. And, well... Essentially, that's a gambling joint, and contrary to what you might think, gambling is very, very important in this game if you want to get a lot of good items. And well, I made a backup save file, or a startup save file, as I like to call them, where if you have the opportunity to grind a lot of stuff like that early on in the game, I'll do it, and it basically becomes a file that I load if I ever want to play a new game. And we're at the very edge of town, so he's saying, hey, don't go that way. But I just kind of one square too many. If we go to this factory now, remember that guy talking about gangs and graffiti? Well, apparently this is the next step into getting Chris, despite talking to his mother and all that. But if we go in here, we can see, oh, this factory. This is, I missed something. Actually, I was supposed to go to that gambling joint. What am I thinking? I'm actually supposed to talk to Mark's bandmates, which that's their hangout spot. I hope I didn't screw things up too much. But I actually got to go back to Joy Street, back to that gambling joint, and talk to Mark's bandmates. I think I got to go one more block. Yeah, for a guy who hasn't beaten this game, I actually know this town pretty well. I've only played roughly 10 hours worth of story in this game. But I have never actually beaten it because I got so caught up in gambling because I like the little poker mini game that I do here. But yeah, I probably could tell that story at some point in time. I'm going to actually start telling it after I talk to his bandmates here. So Mark is in a band with these guys here. Some guy's been snooping around our studio. He's a scar on his face. Damn, he pissed me off. Leave him alone. He'll go away. You're all Mark's friends, right? Huh? Oh, my bad. I want to stay and kick it here, but let's go to the hospital first. We can come back later. And if you talk to this maid girl bartender with a shaven beard, you can trade your money for tokens, and you start the game with 50 bucks. And you can trade them over for some coins, which you can use to play games like poker here. Now, be aware that you can't fight monsters at this point in time in the game. You'll have to go to the hospital first and do the events there. And then the game officially starts. But across the hall here is a save room. And what I like to do early on in the game is grind up a ton of tokens. Because at one point in time or another, I decided I wanted to play through this game four times. One for each of the four... the fifth party member. And those party members are Brad, Elena, Ellen, and Chris. And I wanted to play through and see all the different routes that this game has to offer. I don't think the game is entirely all that different based on who your fifth party member is, but I wanted to have a save file for each party member nonetheless, and so what I ended up doing here is I grinded for 22 hours in-game time, and I have a save file to prove that. And I was grinding up tokens, and I actually pulled that up and looked at it not too long ago, and I had like 30,000 tokens. That's quite a lot, but I could get a lot more, and it's also one of the reasons why I was also hesitant to start the series, because I wanted more tokens, more gambling, get that out of the way. So I wouldn't have to do a ton of token grinding later in the game. And of course, I could always just buy more tokens with lots of money, but then again, I need money for other things. This place is dirty. It reeks in here. So now we're back at the factory. And I believe we get to see Chris here. Hey, Mark, is that your homeboy over there? What's up? Oh, what? Yo, what are you doing here? Obviously, it's Chris. And we get to hear that cool bass line once again. You guys shouldn't come here. You'll get killed. What's up? Hey, what up? Wonder what he's up to, wandering around all over the place. Alright, so at this point, I think we're done with all of Chris's prerequisites, so I'm going to pull up my other file and play from there and show you the end of this episode from there. So I'll be right back. Okay, I was not kidding when I said I spent a lot of time gambling, 23 hours to be precise. And, well, these other four save files are, well, reserved on the memory card, basically, for all four of the stories, or, well, it's the same story, but with a different fifth character, basically. And I think when I was playing through, this was a save file where I got Brad, this was a save file where I got Ellen, This was probably going to be the save file where I got Alana, but I probably didn't make a backup at that time. Because it's like 1 minute difference from this save file here. So I don't know if I got Chris on one of these files or not. Regardless, this is kind of like the beginning of the game save file that I'll be loading up here. You might have also noticed that it's actually got more time on it than the one above it. Because way back when I was doing my token grinding and I played through the game a bit, I got so far then I realized I didn't have enough tokens to really do what I wanted to do. Because the whole point of doing all this early game token grinding for the casinos and all that was so that I didn't only had to do it one time rather than four times for all four save files. And that's kind of why I got stuck here at the beginning of the game, just doing a ton of token grinding. By the way, yes, these doors here are all going to lead to these purple trees. So if you see one that looks like this, then that's your cue to head inside and save your game. And yes, in order to save the game, you carve a record on the trunk of these wisdom trees, I believe they're called. Not entirely sure, but yeah. But just to show off the insanity that I did, I'll open up my inventory real quick and also show you how many tokens I got. And the primary game that I've used for grinding tokens has been blackjack, or not blackjack, poker, just basic regular ass poker. And let's go into the items. Yeah, I got all these items, and all these items are not just stuff that you can get from the casino. But I would buy stuff and then sell it at a normal store, and then I would go all around town and buying all the items from the shops. So that's why I got like the candies and magic rocks and herbs and all kinds of stuff. But yeah, let's just take a look at how many coins I got even after I got all the items at this point in time in the game. At least I think I got them all. I don't remember really because this was like a decade ago when I did all this grinding. So yeah, it's just regular old poker. You get the choice to hold any of your cards into the second round, and then when you take a draw, you'll get a random shuffle of cards, and well, you can hopefully pray and cross your fingers and hope to get a hand. And I'd like to at least get one hand here on camera to show kind of what I do normally to grind tokens. So, got three of a kind, and that's, I put 10 coins in, I got 30 back for getting three of a coin. If you were to get a royal flush, you'd hit the jackpot, and that'll be at the top left corner of the screen when we're on the main menu. But I like to do big and small because the odds are always, or almost always, greater than 50%. If you want to double your money. And, well, it's video lottery, so expect to get screwed over a whole bunch. And I'll probably play one more. You'll see at the top right corner where it says bet 10, and underneath it is JP, and the jackpot is at the top left corner. It's, what, 10,000 tokens or so? So, yeah, that's a lot if you get a royal flush, but hell will probably freeze over before you get one of those. Alright, so let's end this here and just kind of show off a couple of the other casino video lottery games. Slot machine, I'll probably do one or two rounds because I really never ever get good luck on this. You have to get a really good lucky roll on this, and it's like the five big ones and all the little ones, and you have the choice to, stop whenever. But I think if you get 777, you also get the jackpot as well. I think the more you play, the higher the jackpot goes up. But it takes a lot of luck to get one of those. There's also a blackjack table. This is what I actually recommend to start out with if you're trying to get a lot of tokens with not a lot of money. And this is a code breaker. I believe in order to play this game, you have to have a specific item. I believe it's called a metal ticket, if I'm not mistaken. But yeah, that's just kind of where you can go to get a lot of good stuff in the early game. And yes, I can kind of recall all this off the top of my head. Aside from the fact that I did a little bit of a refresher before this recording, just to kind of jog my memory on things. But it's also because I played through the very early game so many times, just trying to get this perfect startup file. And, well, I've only played about the first 10 or so hours of this game, but I played through it several times. I do not know what's up later in the game, or how the end game of this is like, or even how long this game is. So, basically, once I get to a certain point in this Let's Play, it'll be blind from there on out. But I did do a lot of homework and stuff, seeing, you know, I kind of wanted to know why Chris was so special, why there's so much you gotta do to get him, in comparison to the other characters, and I found out he gets some of the best personas in the game, but you have to do a lot just to, you get to jump through a lot of hoops just to get him. Anywho, we've headed off to the hospital here, and there's a lot more of the town that I could explore, but, well, I'm trying to keep this under an hour or so, so instead, we're just gonna head straight to where Mary is. There's still a lot of time before our checkup. Let's go see Mary first. Always so practical. Mary's in room 302. Mark? How'd you know that? I think he likes her, buddies. I think he likes her, guys. Shut up, my buddies told me. Hey, Steve, let's hurry. Alright, so, in order to go inside the hospital, just go through that door there. Apparently, we don't need an appointment or anything. I'm impressed we already made our appointment. Either way, 302 means third floor, second room. I'm pretty sure that means second on the right, because, well, it'll have a different looking plaque next to the door. So this one is kind of yellowish. This one is kind of whitish. This one is kind of whitish, so yeah, it'll be this door here. And this place is pretty big. You can actually explore it in full. Most of the rooms will be locked like this, but some of the rooms you can go in and talk to people in their rooms. You know, probably some old people will like to see a visit from you, and we're not going to do that. There's just too much dialogue in this game to really mess with all that. So instead, we're going to go here and visit Mary. Well, I'm going home now, but be sure to get some fresh air. It's an important part of rehabilitation, too. That's right, Mary. We'll go for a walk tomorrow. Mary's been in the hospital for 1 year due to minor mental delusions. Mary, your friends have arrived. I'll see you later, Mary. Alright, so, it's visitation hours and all that. Steve and everybody, thank you. Mark especially, thank you. Why a special thanks to Mark? When Mark came to see me last time, I told him that I'd like to see everybody. Isn't that right? I guess he does like her, because he's been visiting her a lot, apparently. Alright, yes it is. TG will come to visit you too. Bring a book of yours. I think it's called Gate to Paradise. Oh, she can still keep it if she wants. I've read it so much I practically memorized it. Okay, I'll tell her if I see her before then. Well, how are you doing? I'm getting better. I'm seeing really nice dreams now, but I can't really remember much. But I do remember I was dreaming about a very kind man like my father. Like that doctor? He seems to be a nice person. I don't like him.
Something happened?
No, nothing like that. I just don't like doctors in general. Oh yeah, how's your mother? She works for Sebec, right? Remember that name well, people. She's not my mother. Anyone who loves her jobs more than me is not my mother. She doesn't care about me. Sorry, I asked. Ooh. Touché. Excuse me, my voice is getting a bit hoarse after all this. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to go off on you like that. Oh, Oh, something's happening. And that music doesn't sound good. It's very foreboding. No! Mary, what's wrong? Are you okay? Mary? Call the doctor! And we're outside the ICU. You don't know what that stands for. It's Intensive Care Unit. Otherwise known as an emergency room. I don't know if that's Japanese or anything like that, but that's the abbreviation here, at least. Will Mary be alright? Damn. Uh-oh. What's happening? Is this an earthquake? It sure is a big one. Stopped. Is Mary alright? What just happened? What happened to the room? Where's Mary? How can this be? This is the ICU room. What just happened to it? Eek. Okay, someone's in trouble! I don't know if that's Mary or not. From downstairs. See, let's go! So, probably not Mary. And looks like we've got zombies! What are these things? I just told you, Yugi. These people came from the morgue. They're dead! They suddenly got up and started walking. That old man there tried to protect us, but was struck down by them. You mean these guys are dead and now they're alive? What the? Old man? You mean Alfred? Alfred! Zombies, how dare you! And here we go, our first battle! And look at the combat system. This whole thing is pretty much just going to be autoplay, but... I'll kill you all! Be careful! But they're all dead, what do we do? And something has arisen! After being provoked out of us, of course, because the zombie attacked us. And here's our first persona on screen. It's mine. And that was a wind attack, and it did 8 damage, but it was enough to kill him. I'm you. You're me. I've emerged from your soul. I can help you. That also did 8 damage. I guess this is a fixed battle with fixed damage. And Yuki's got a pretty cool persona there. Also, I should like to point out the stuff that we got equipped here. Normally, you don't see this fight where your characters have all these weapons in their hands. Aside from the fact that I had actually unequipped Yuki because she's only a temporary party member for this small portion of the game. She normally throws razors at enemies, so she's basically got throwing daggers. Once again, she's only a permanent party member in the other quest, or the other story, which is only available in the Japanese version, and I think possibly updated versions of this, but this is the original PS1 version, so we ain't gonna be able to do the Snow Queen quest on this disc. So either way, we got a scalpel and a mop. Those are normally the first weapons you get, and you probably equip them on the main character, Steve in my case, and Nate. Because Nate is normally going to be equipped with a two-handed sword, and the main character uses one-handed swords. Mark uses axes, and for whatever reason, he comes equipped with one at the start of the game, so... yeah, he is a bit of a troublemaker. Alright, so we leveled up in the very first battle of the game, and this is obviously forced upon us, and it's kind of giving you a little bit of a tutorial. I wouldn't really call it much of a tutorial on, you know, whenever you level up, you can distribute points to stats, and you get 3 per level, I think. I'm not sure if that's all the way up to the max level, but I like to point out, see how I'm putting points into strength when there's this red bar and how my stat is not going up? In order to increase the stats that have these red bars, you have to max out the red bar, and then you'll be able to get more points and stats. I think that's caused by your persona. If not your persona, then your equipment. You can't actually boost the core stat until you've actually gotten rid of that red bar. But if I were to put a point into vitality, which obviously is defense, as you can see in the upper right corner of the stat screen, the defense goes up when I put points into that. And tech, you can see my accuracy goes up. So I will do that, and we also get some automatic bonuses to our stats because I didn't boost strength at all, so our attack is going up. So, and I don't remember what DMP, DOD, and OMP stand for. But you can also see that we've got two forms of attack, weapons and guns. So I think guns mostly come into play later. I think they're like the second dungeon in the game. You have to go raid the police station with all these zombies running about and stuff, and you'll steal guns from the police station because, well, the police ain't doing squat because they've been taken over. But yeah, monsters are now running all around town, and it's a result of that weird earthquake. And a lot more than just an earthquake and monsters roaming around town has happened as a result. As you'll see in just a minute when we get back out into the hospital main area dungeon, the layout of the hospital has been warped beyond belief, so it's kind of like dimension warping as well. But right now we have a bit of a sad scene. Alfred, don't die. You're not going to leave me behind, are you, Alfred? Please don't look so sad. It doesn't suit your handsome face. You're a fine young man. You'll learn to stand on your own one day. This is it for me. My days are gone. No. I won't allow this to happen. Please, Alfred, hold on. Goodbye. Just one last thing. Promise you'll stand on your own. Become someone great in this world. Yeah, I will. I will become a great man someday, and I'll prove myself to you. You just wait and see, Alfred. Master, I will always be with you in your heart and soul. Alfred? Alfred! Say something, Alfred! Alfred! And all of us in the corner just kind of look away. Nate. Leave him alone. Hey, Steve, do you hear them just now? They said something to us. Mm-hmm. I heard it too. Could that have been the persona? Said it would give us power. I don't think they're our enemies. If we work it right, they might just help us out. Let's just call them persona. Not sure what to make of it just yet, but you could be right. I just have a bad feeling about this whole thing. Let's go check outside. Alright, so one interesting thing about this game as well is that you can actually save battle formations, and I have this one loaded already. Yuki is here in the back, primarily because she should be throwing daggers, but she's not because I unequipped her. And, oops, I forgot. I didn't hit the OK button on that. But it's giving us the option to re-equip ourselves. Let's go back into the formation. But this game is a pretty dynamic formation system in that you have all these spots that you can put your characters in. And range is a very big, important thing in battle. So let's say you had a healer character. You want to have that person in the back so they're not taking much damage. And hopefully that healer character also has ranged attacks as well. And like I've been going over already, there's a bunch of different fifth party members. So you can kind of customize your party a little bit. But, you know, the main characters, Steve in my case again, Nate and Mark are going to be required. And they're short range party members. And I think Mark in particular is very short ranged. So, yeah, you probably want to put Mark in the middle. Anyways, we're going to do this first battle here, and I'm going to try and do something interesting. Yeah, if you go into contact here, you can contact one of the monsters. And should we talk to the static monster or the zombie girl? Let's go with the zombie girl, since she's in front. Now we're going to start with Mark. He's usually got the best stuff most of the time. Dance and Lie tend to be the things that I want to use the most, because if you look in the top left corner of the screen, you see there's Joy, Anger, Fear, and Interest. By contacting monsters like this, you can actually talk to the monsters and try to get stuff from them. Let's say you boosted Fear, for example. We provoked them, and they got scared, and if we make them fearful, you can actually force them to run away or cause them to be timid, which will be a stat debuff. But if you try and boost their interest, which is really what I want to go for, or joy and interest are the best two. Anger, well, if you make them angry, they can, you know, get buffed instead of debuffed, or they can get really pissed off or intimidate you and paralyze one of your characters. But Joy, they might actually give you an item or heal you, and that'll end the battle. Or they might run away. Just, you know, a whole bunch of different things can happen just based on the monster itself. So let's try lying to these zombies and try flattering. I don't think they got very high IQ and all that, being dead, shambling monsters and all that. Oh, my lovely child. Zombie girl, you look great. After all, I know you just want to talk, right? You know, I know, because I'm so cute. So that actually made her a bit happy, and so we're going to try dancing to her now. Hey, get off the stage. You're terrible. Okay. Sometimes staring, you know, they might take that being, you know, are you really interested in me? Are you hitting on me? Oh, even after I become like this. Guys, still look at me. See, that's what I'm talking about. I guess beauty doesn't die. Okay, let's try lying one more time and try flattering her. Yeah, she's not too bright being a zombie girl and all that. Let me feel warm just by staying by you. I'll give you something special this time. So she gave us a magic stone. Ooh. Oh, she healed us. If you were a zombie next time I see you. What if you were a zombie? Oh, what if you were a zombie next time I see you? So they actually ran away after healing Mark there. That's pretty nice. This is really one of the funnest things about the combat system, is just being able to talk to monsters. You don't actually have to fight battles normally. I mean, there's the usual stuff where you can actually, you know, run, fight, change your formation. You can try analyzing. I don't know how good that would be. In Autodactyl, but the contact system is really the biggest thing that separates this game from other RPGs, and no other RPG, to my knowledge, really did this before. Okay, so he's angry because he doesn't believe our lies. So oftentimes, if they want to taste your energy, that means, you know, they're... This sometimes, I don't even know if this reduces HP or not. It's just one of those things they ask for. But oftentimes I just say yes and, well, I get on with it. But we'll try something else. I had a good time, so give me something. Oh, you're a selfish one, aren't you? No, thanks. I don't want to increase his joy all the way. I want to try and get his interest up. So we're going to try Nate instead. Actually, can I persuade this one? Seems to be a bit greedy. Eh? No, I don't want to make that. Let's see here. Let's try being nice to them and invite it. So he's afraid of us trying to recruit him. Let's try singing. This usually has the same effect as dancing. No, I guess not. He's actually angry and happy at the same time. So we can get both of the effects at the same time. So he attacked us, and he runs away. So that's one of the things that can happen if you increase joy and anger at the same time. All right, we're going to try and find one more battle. And hopefully, or maybe two battles, I'm not entirely sure. But we're going to try and find a couple battles. And also look at the mini-map. Notice how different it is from when we were in that room. Yeah, the hospital has been warped around. And actually, we're on the basement now, which is really, really weird. Yeah, stuff really happened when that earthquake hit. And the dimension has been warped. And the whole layout of this building has been changed as a result. So, yeah. This is like out of some kind of horror flick or something like that. let's try the zombies, the normal ones this time. Let's try dancing. I usually like to do this one first. This is usually... Oh, we got interest up. That's really what I'm trying to go for and show you guys, is what happens when you get their interest up. Never been to a disco. What kind of place is it? Alright, so now he's interested in what we're doing. I think if we keep doing this... this sucks. That was kind of interesting. They all have kind of funny dialogue, by the way. What do you want from me? Now, if we say spell card... this is really what you want to do if you want to build your personas. Because you can get spell cards from any monster in the game. Or at least most of them. And you can take it to that velvet room, which I pointed out before, where Igor hangs out. And Igor can fuse different monster spell cards into other personas. And that's how you get other sets of magic. Now if I go into magic here in the menu, you can see I've got personas. I start off with Starion. Isn't that like a constellation? Not that sure. Voodoo, I'm pretty sure you know what voodoo is. Shaman, also, you know, wow, well, we got a lot of African personas this time around. And Yuki, Vesta, I don't recognize Vesta, really. I'm thinking it's probably some mythological or religious figure, but I'm not entirely sure. But those are our current personas. By getting a bunch of spell cards, you want to do a contacting a lot, but you also want to battle a lot, because you can't get the spell card of a monster unless if your level is below theirs. Or at least I think your average level? I'm not entirely sure, but our entire party is like level 6 right now. So I think we're above the level of everything else here. Is that Jack Frost? No, that's not Jack Frost. A Wraith. These little guys are kind of funny. I'll try and get Pixie. Actually, no, we're not gonna contact them this time. This time around, we're actually gonna fight. And let's see, I'm gonna attack him with a sword. I'm trying to actually change targets right now, but you can see this zombie is the closest one, and he's the only one within Steve's range right now. Same thing goes for Nate. He can actually attack. One of those two, and I think, was I actually able to change targets? I don't think I was. I think he just picks one of the two. I think he actually picks the closest one. Now, Mark can attack either of these two. Wait, now I remember. Nate has this weird sword which it hits multiple times, so it actually hit both of them. That's why it was blink. Well, that's why both of them were blinking. I kind of... It's coming back to me. And Yuki, she can't actually hit someone because she's unarmed. Oh, crap. I actually hit circle, and we started everything over. Okay, so let's do this. And triangle goes back one step. Okay, so you can see her being unarmed and way in the back row. She can't actually hit anyone. But Persona usually can hit anyone in the field. It's dependent on the Persona. But we're going to have her attack with her Persona. And everyone should get their turn. Wow, that's a pretty brutal sword you got there, Nate. Thank you, Mr. Casino Person, or Mrs. Casino Person. It's kind of ambiguous. But Yuki is going to cast her Blast Spell and hit that zombie. And... Yeah, now that we've killed a few in the front row, All the other monsters in the back will be moved to the front so we can actually attack them. Now, she's way to the right and Steve is way to the left, so she's also out of his range. Nate can attack with a sword, Merc also, and Yuki once again, Persona. So, this is one last battle that I really want to show here, but now that we've beaten the enemies, let's take a look at our experience and just everything else on the screen. So we all got EXP from this fight. Merc didn't really get a whole lot because he didn't get to do much. Did he even get a chance to attack? I don't remember if he did. But he just kind of sat there. So you really have to plan out the moves, or plan out your moves every time you get into a battle. Or just spam personas all the time. Because if you spam personas, notice how Yuki got a lot of PP? What the PP is essentially persona experience points. So, or persona points. I'm not entirely sure what the exact abbreviation is. But if you use your personas a lot, they will also level up alongside you. So there is both the character level and the persona level. And I also got a metal card. I think that's the thing I need to use in the casino to play that Codebreaker game. I thought they were a lot more rare than that, but we got them one on our third fight. But if you level up your personas a lot, they'll learn new moves. And I don't know if that was enough to level up Yuki's persona. Actually, I don't think it was because it would have shown on that screen. But yeah, you can actually level up different personas, and that's what you're going to be wanting to do all your grinding with later in the game. Oops. I keep forgetting. Frick. This thing has very weird controller configs, so if I want to go back one, yeah, I have to hit triangle, and circle closes the menu entirely, because circle, for whatever reason, is the menu button, where most games it's triangle or square, and circle is usually the back button, whereas in this game it's triangle. Very weird controller config. But yeah, you can take a look at your personas, you can get a little picture here, you can get their stats if you go up and down. You can also see what tarot they belong to. So Yuki's Vesta belongs to the Empress tarot family. And it's kind of why you get spell cards whenever you contact an enemy and get their interest up. Let's take a look. So Mark's Voodoo was a shaman. Is a chariot persona, and this is his original one. And you see he's got also, I believe he's a physical based, and I believe he's weak against gravity, I think. Oh, it says right there, reflect gravity and weak against spirit. So this is a physical gravity type. And so there's a whole bunch to the combat system. I probably could just go over a lot of different things, but you know, you can take a look at things. We're just gonna really take a quick look. This one is a Hierophant, the Voodoo, which is apparently a holy elemental. That's kind of weird. And my persona is a wind elemental. So yeah, there's just a whole big combat system. The persona customization system is really, really, really big. And so, yeah, it gets really in-depth, but I'm just kind of trying to gloss over as much as I can in a short period of time. But I think at this point, we're going to end this episode off here. Like I said before, this LP hasn't officially started just yet. I'm hoping to try and finish Grandia and Armored Core Project Phantasma pretty soon. It'll be a while before I actually finish Suikoden 2, because we're still kind of towards the beginning of that game. And also, come February, it'll be the Legend of Zelda 30th anniversary, and I plan to do a Zelda game then. I might actually do some pre-recording for that Let's Play and try to get over that, with try to finish that quickly, but yeah, we're just going to do Zelda then, and maybe sometime late spring, middle of summer, I don't know, we'll get back to this game. Whenever Twilight Princess finishes up. Because I think we'll be able to finish up Project Phantasma, and then we'll just stick to doing Grandia and Suikoden 2. And after that, you know, once I finish up one of these three Let's Plays, I'll move into Persona 2, but only after we finish up Legend of Zelda Twilight Princess, and that's going to be the main focus. And it'll probably be the only Let's Play I'll be doing once we get that far, because I love Zelda, and that is my favorite title. Also, we'll be doing the GameCube version, because I don't really have a good way to record the Wii U version, much less the actual gamepad, which is kind of forgettable in the grand scheme of Let's Playing, but I don't have a capture device right now that records HDMI input, so I can't even record off the TV, or straight off the Wii U, which I'm using. So yeah, we'll be doing the GameCube version. I could show everything on screen there. And I think it's superior to the original Wii version. And well, I would do the remake if I could record everything, but I just can't. So that's where we're at. And I think I babbled on long enough. So look forward to this sometime middle 2017. And I'll just say, Merry Christmas, Dark Kefka! Surprise Christmas present. And I'll say thanks to everyone else for watching. See you guys next time, or whenever.